Well, it has been 9 months since the final episode of the Daily Gaily podcast. We're facing something pretty unprecedented at the moment, which to me felt like maybe the best time for some new episodes. Right now, we're facing 6 weeks of no school, which is a pretty serious measure. Some of you might be wondering why we would take such drastic action when there aren't really that many sick people. At least, not yet. Well, that why question is exactly why I felt it important to reboot this podcast. To justify to you, my students, and hopefully former students, why we've closed schools and taken other drastic steps. Everything here revolves around a concept called flattening the curve. It's a term you might have heard already, but maybe don't fully understand. Put simply, it's the exact reason for the recent call for social distancing practices that have led us to not have school. But first, we have to talk a bit about our healthcare system. We do not have sufficient medical resources to treat every single person in the United States at the same time, which is a reasonable thing. The cost of maintaining those resources would be so much as to make healthcare inaccessible. Now, we could debate over the number of people we should be able to treat simultaneously, but that conversation is beyond this episode and beyond me. So, how many can we treat at once? Well, the Organization for Economic Cooperation and Development, or OECD, has compiled and published a list of hospital beds per 1,000 people in different countries. Here in the United States, we have about 2.77 beds per 1,000 people. Given the roughly 327 million people in the United States, that means we have just shy of 1 million hospital beds in this country. Put another way, we can simultaneously treat about one quarter of 1% of our population at a given time if they have a serious illness. Maybe you see where I'm going here. There is still a lot about the COVID-19 coronavirus that we don't understand. Here's what I can say, though. Some people risk serious illness and possible death when infected, and the virus is spreading fast. It seems likely that a good percentage of the United States will be infected by the virus over the next year. This number will almost certainly eclipse 1 million people, the number of hospital beds we have available to treat people. Given that we have not succeeded in containing the spread of the virus, we're putting our energy and effort to controlling the spread. This is where the concept of flattening the curve comes in. Okay, let's make up some fake numbers for the sake of clarity. Let's say it's inevitable that 50 million people in the United States are going to be infected with COVID-19 by March of next year. If all of those infections occur at the same time, let's say between now and the end of April, we're in serious trouble. There won't be enough hospital beds and other necessary medical equipment to treat everyone. Genuinely sick people might end up being turned away from hospitals because they don't have the resources or staff to treat everyone. However, if we can prolong the spread of the disease, increase the time period in which those 50 million people get sick, then we can entirely avoid the maximum capacity of our healthcare system. In both cases, we have the same number of people getting sick, but the outcomes are entirely different. In the first case, we'll have untreated people, more likely to spread the virus and risking a greater chance of death. While in the second case, people can get the care they need, minimizing the overall impact of the virus. Hopefully, my students are making some cross-disciplinary connections here. This is actually a lot like the concept of impulse. If you can maximize the time a collision takes place, you can minimize the force felt. If you're driving a car and you're about to hit a barrier, the impulse you feel is fixed. Your momentum has to go to zero. But if you're hitting a highway crash barrier and your car has a crumple zone, then the increased time of the collision will minimize the force felt during that collision, keeping you safe. And that's what these social distancing measures are about. That's why we're not in school. It's too late to avoid the crash, but it's not too late to minimize the impact we all feel. Washing your hands, closing school, avoiding large gatherings of people, these are our crumple zones, our crash barriers, and our buffer stops. So most importantly, stay healthy and stay safe. But also, since schools are closed, try to stay intellectually engaged and curious.